following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Talk.
UBM Praise proudly presents Warriors Talk. Warriors Talk. Warriors Talk. Warriors Talk. Warriors Talk. Warriors Talk. Warriors Talk.
You have just tuned in to Warriors Talk with your host, Lady Rochelle. Warriors Talk is a platform to address how cancer, as well as other diseases, are running rampant throughout our country and how we can move away from awareness to taking action. Warriors Talk will empower listeners by keeping them informed, connected to services, and encourage them to thrive while surviving.
But I'm stronger. You thought that I'd be broke without you, but I'm richer. You thought that I'd be sad without you, I love harder. Thought I wouldn't grow without you, now I'm wiser. Thought that I'd be helpless without you, but I'm smarter. You thought that I'd be stressed without you, but I'm chilling. You thought I wouldn't sell without you, so I'm not millions.
Welcome to Warriors Talk. I am your host, Lady Rochelle, on UBM Talk, and I'm so excited you have chosen to tune in today. It is Testimonial Tuesday, and I want everyone to stay connected with me on all forms of social media, Facebook/Warriors Talk with the Nest, Twitter at Warriors Talk 1, Instagram Warriors Talk 1. And if you ever miss a show, you can always go to Spreaker.com, and that's Spreaker.com. Follow me, and I will follow you back. You can also subscribe to my channel on YouTube, Warriors Talk with Lady Rochelle, as I keep my eyes on the community and report back to you the things that are going on that involves cancer. You can also call in at 312-754-4333, and we would love to hear from you. This show is actually dedicated to anyone who's dealing with a cancer recurrence. We know that hearing you have cancer for the first time can be devastating and life-altering, but hearing it for the second and the third time can make you feel like you are suffocating. But there is hope, and we know that on this show, we have heard from many survivors who have already taken that journey. And I do want to apologize because we was having technical issues for the last couple of weeks, so the last time we actually had a show was July the 5th, and our topic was understanding strokes, signs, symptoms, and treatment. And we left you with some information on how to recognize when someone is having a stroke. And the important thing to remember is response time. And remember the word FAST, F-A-S-T. The F is for face drooping. The A is for arm weakness. The S is for speech difficulty. And the T is for time to call 911. And we know that stroke is responsible for 6.7 million deaths around the world in 2012. According to WHO, the World Health Organization, that figures represent about 11.9% of all deaths. And according to the Center for Disease Control, that nearly is 130,000 people in the United States that actually die from a stroke each year. That's one person every 4 minutes. So about one in four strokes actually occur in people who have already had strokes. And strokes also is the leading cause of disability as well. Our healing scripture is coming from Ephesians 6, 11 through 18. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet sod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
Cancer is a very scary word. If I was to sum up the most fearful things in life, it would be at the top, getting cancer. So, you know, it's been a very difficult experience for me. And I'm getting a lot better at accepting it. And the grieving process was, you know, after it all sunken in, why me? You know, I take care of myself, I stay healthy, I eat right, this is awful. You know, it's after the surgery and everything calms down, and I think you come out of that grieving process and start to celebrate the fact that you're cancer free.
And we know that many have already experienced this, that scary feeling when you go to the doctor and you hear those three words, you have cancer. Now, having to hear those words has also put you in the mode to go to war. How are you going to fight this? And we know that as being Christians, we also have times when we're under attack as well. But in order to withstand these attacks, we must know that we can depend on God for strength in every piece of his armor that he has. And the whole body needs to be protected. So we're talking about you have to be mentally, physically, and spiritually prepared to fight this war. And you got to make sure that you have on the proper war gear. So our topic for today, which is our battle of the day, is ready for war. And here to share her journey is a 7-year survivor, age 51, who was very courageous in her fight. And she didn't let her diagnosis paralyze her with fear as she took on the fight of her life. She has a very infectious smile, illuminating personality, and she was able to find her strength in her struggle. Welcome to Warriors Talk, Monica Gilmore Ryder. Welcome, Monica.
Thank you.
I'm so excited you're here today, and I'm just even hearing part of your journey. I'm just amazed by everything that you have been through and that you're still standing and looking gorgeous doing it.
Wow. Thank you.
And I wish my Facebook Live was working, because then I can show y'all exactly how gorgeous she looked. But what we're going to do is we're going to allow Monica to take us on her journey.
Wow. Well, it was a very, very challenging journey. I'm a little nervous, so I'm going to do the best I can in telling my story and hoping that whatever I say can help someone that may be going through the same thing. I had a normal, what I feel was a normal life in 2008. And what I mean by that, I was a foster parent of 5 children and 1 granddaughter at the time that I found out. And let me start by saying, at the time, I was in a new relationship with my significant other, whom actually found the lump for me.
Wow.
It shocked me. Actually took his hands and said, there's something that you need to address. And we need to get to the doctor as soon as possible. And this was in August of 2008. I honestly did not take it serious. I called the doctor and made an appointment instead of telling the appointment clerk that I had a lump. Mm-hmm. So I waited from August until January of 2009 before I was even seen.
Wow.
In January of 2009, I walked into the mammogram office, sat just like a regular person, and assumed everything was okay with me and that I was just going to get a mammogram and leave. Instead, when I walked in the back, undressed, waited for my name to be called, talked to the people that were sitting next to me as if we were going to have a regular day. That wasn't just a regular day for me. I didn't just walk out after my mammogram. My mammogram was very painful. Very painful. After taking the pictures and coming out of the room, I sat down. Everyone in the room was leaving but me. Everyone in the room that came in with me left. I started sweating up under my arms. I started sweating in my head. I walked out and went into the restroom and called my mom as I was crying, saying, "Ma, I can't leave. They told me that they found something and they needed to take more pictures."
Now, did anyone comfort you while you were in that room? Did anyone besides the women that you were in there with come and say anything to you to bring some type of comfort, to assure you that this was just routine?
The lady that took, the technician that took my pictures, assured me that everything was going to be okay. She came back in and said, "Miss Ryder, the doctor will be with you shortly. Everything is okay. We just need to take more pictures to see if they are clearer." That what was told to me. Now, people that was there, ladies that were waiting for their mammogram as well, they comforted me because I just couldn't stop crying, couldn't stop sweating, because I knew, I just felt it, that something was wrong. My mom prayed with me. I went back in the room and sat down, and then I was called in. The technician called me in the back and showed me on the screen the pictures, mm-hmm. and said I needed a mammogram, an ultrasound. They scheduled me an appointment for an ultrasound, but leaving, just knowing, mm-hmm. just leaving the office, just knowing
that there's a possibility.
That was a possibility, yes.
What was the time length between that, the appointment, and the time that you were there?
Maybe about close to 2 hours. Close to 2 hours.
Okay.
From taking the mammogram and then taking more mammogram pictures after the ones that I had taken before, and after the physician in the back looking at the pictures.
And then when they gave you the other appointment, how far out was it?
2 weeks.
Oh, wow.
It was about 2 weeks.
They made you wait 2 weeks?
It was about 2 weeks before I had to do the ultrasound. Yes.
Wow, that's a long time mm-hmm. to sit with that on your brain.
Yes. Mind you, I had 5 foster children at home that I still needed to take care of while waiting.
Wow.
Fast forwarding to taking the ultrasound and still waiting for another appointment for the biopsy. So I had to wait for the biopsy appointment and having lymph nodes removed as well.
Oh, wow.
Still waiting. It wasn't within 24 hours. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It had to be within weeks again. Because everything happened like the next month where I got the results back in February. And the results were grade 2, stage 3, HER2 positive, aggressive breast cancer.
Wow.
I received that phone call. I couldn't breathe. It was like I had asthma. I just wanted to ball up in a knot and not ever breathe again. And I did ask, why me? I did.
Excuse me. Take your time. We all have that question. Why me?
So moving forward, Lady Rochelle, moving forward, after noticing that I had to change my whole life, I had to have the children removed and placed into other foster homes. I didn't know. I didn't know what to do. I honestly didn't. Yes, my mom prayed. I prayed, but everything to me was thrown out of the window. I didn't want to think. I didn't want to breathe. I didn't want to pray. I wanted to be mad.
When you say everything was thrown out of the window,
for me, life. I just
everything
I just,
that you had planned.
Everything that I had planned.
Okay. Cancer would do that to you. It is life altering. Not only your life, but you had five foster kids, so not only your life was altered, but theirs was altered as well once they had a stable home.
Yes.
You know, someone that they can depend on, look up to, that they knew that was going to take care of them. But you were going through your own issues.
Absolutely.
What did I mean, I couldn't even imagine having to have my babies taken away. You know, because you feel like nobody can take care of your babies better than you can.
Exactly.
And you want to be able to worry about them, but then you want to be well enough to take care of them as well.
Exactly.
What was going through your mind with that? I don't even
sadness. Imagine. Sadness, sorrow. We made up, we still had visits.
Okay.
And that was still, to me, even worse. Because tearing them away from me. And not being able to pull the two-month-old out of my arms to go to the new parent at the time.
Wow.
Heartbreaking.
Wow. What helped you to prepare for this journey? Like, everybody has a strategy when they're getting ready for war. What was your strategy to help you prepare for what you had to go through? Because you hear the different stories,
mm-hmm.
but everybody's journey is totally different. You know, what affects one person may not affect you in that same way. So what did you do to prepare for war?
I didn't prepare.
That's an honest answer.
I didn't prepare. My mother was praying for me. Our church home, St. Joseph Missionary Baptist Church, the prayer warriors were there because I felt that I didn't have the strength. She worked nights in every treatment. When she got off work, she was there. Daphne Chancellor is a breast cancer survivor as well and came to the hospital to take care of me.
Wow.
I prayed. And please don't take this in the wrong way, but I have to be honest. As the chemo needles and the setup for me to sit for my treatment, I asked for my Benadryl, and I wanted to go to sleep and not wake up for those 3 hours that I was waiting for my treatment. I didn't care about the bald head. I didn't care about the beauty. But my granddaughter and my youngest daughter, that's 24 now, she was in her last year of college. And she said, Ma, what are you going to do? I'm graduating. I can't do this without you.
Oh, wow.
I found strength.
It seemed like you had a good support system around you. Mothers, I tell you, are a blessing.
Yes.
Even when you feel like you can't, just having that mother there to push you and to intercede on your behalf to say, baby, don't worry about it. You can. So even though you think you didn't have a plan, somebody else had a plan for you in place, mm-hmm. and they was praying to the one upstairs. That's the only one who was going to be able to turn your situation around. And I'm telling you, those prayer warriors, you know, when once they get together, it's like fire.
Yes.
And God hears them. And he steps in. And he does it in his own timing. We would like for him to move when we want him to move.
Right.
But he does it in his own timing. Right. And I really, truly believe that he selected us for a reason. For a reason. And even though when we're going through the process, we don't like it. Mm-mm. All of the stuff that it's doing to us, stripping us of our beauty, mm-hmm. your hair, your nails, your eyebrows, your eyelashes, even with the skin turning dark, even if you get, you know, you lose part of your breast, one breast, two breasts, even the losing the weight, like all of that, because men are visual. Let's keep it real. Men are visual.
I agree.
So when you are losing all of that, it could be devastating to you, and you could want to give up. You don't even want to look in the mirror at yourself. You're like, who is this person?
Right.
And it takes some type of inner strength inside of you, and that core inside of you, you know, to say, I can make it. And when you hear the little voices, like your daughter was like, I can't do this without you.
Mm-hmm.
Then you like, okay, let me wipe these tears. Let me go ahead and do what I got to do, because I got to be here for this. I got to be here for them.
Right.
And you somehow find the strength to do that. They give you that strength. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love the kids because they keep you young. They keep you active. And they always, you can find something that they're doing to make you smile.
Yeah.
To, like my daughter used to tell me when I had the bald head, she would say, I love your hair, Mommy. And I'm like, there's no hair on my head. But she would always tell me that. And I'm just like, why she keeps saying that? My head is completely bald. But she would say it. So I don't know if she saw in the future, she saw Mommy with hair. But she would always tell me, I love your hair.
Mm-hmm.
And that made me feel so good, you know, sure. just to have her there and to, you know, to keep me busy. Because they, you know, kids keep you busy and they kind of keep your mind off what you're going through. So you had a good support system around you, even with the other survivors coming in and taking care of you because they already been through it, so they know exactly what you're going to be going through.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to grab hold to our support system because they're going to be the ones that's going to breathe life back into us when we're not able to do it.
Yes.
So I'm excited that you're here, and I'm glad that you didn't let go. And I'm glad that you didn't allow this situation to suffocate you and to take away that beautiful smile that you have and this incredible journey that you have to share with other people to let them know that there is hope, that cancer is not a death sentence, and that you can make it. So here is Kurt Carr with Almost Let Go.
This song says, God's mercy kept me so I wouldn't let go. Anybody in here ever felt like giving up, just throwing in the towel, just giving up? I'm not going to ask you to hunch anybody, but just look at them. That person you're looking at is here tonight only because of God's mercy and his grace. Somebody ought to just tell God, thank you for your mercy and your grace that kept me. Thank you.
a witness in here.
So I wouldn't let go.
I almost gave up.
I almost gave up. I was right at the edge of a breakthrough, but couldn't see it.
God's mercy kept me.
God's mercy.
Can I get a witness in here that knows about God's grace? So I'm here today. Somebody next to me. I was really down. The devil really had me. But God's mercy kept me. I'm here tonight because of God's mercy. Come on now, just thank him. Just thank him.
I almost let go.
Life, renters, or business insurance. Paula Kelly and her staff specialize in all your insurance needs. Paula Kelly Allstate Insurance Agency is located at 297 East Glenwood, Lansing Road, Glenwood, Illinois. Give her a call today, 708-758-3300, or email her at paulakelly@allstate.com, PAULAKELLY at allstate.com. Or show her some love and like her on Facebook and get your quotes for what you need today. You're in good hands with Allstate.
At Emmanuel Church of God in Christ, Pastor Michael A. Richardson serves as our pastor. Emmanuel is located at 3058 West Van Buren in Chicago, Illinois, 60612. Order of services on Sundays at 9:30 a.m. is Sunday school. Morning worship takes place at 11 a.m. Every first Sunday, we have pastoral prayer at 9 a.m. and Holy Communion is served after the morning worship service. Join us for Bible studies on Wednesdays, 6:45 for prayer and 7 for the Bible Institute classes. Join us at Emmanuel, where we are building upon a solid foundation.
And you are tuned in to Warriors Talk here on UBM Talk with Lady Rochelle, and we are moving away from awareness towards taking action. Warriors Talk is all about early detection, knowing your risk, reducing your risk, knowing your family history, and selecting healthier lifestyle choices. So right now we are talking to the beautiful Monica Gilmore Ryder, who is a cancer survivor, and she is sharing her personal journey with us. And I'm just going to tell you that she truly does not look like what she's been through. So I'm going to show you guys what she looks like. She's very beautiful. She's trying to hide that beautiful smile of hers as well. So we're excited. If you guys missed the first half, we do apologize because you did miss a treat. But we're talking about cancer right now. And she is a cancer survivor. And according to the American Cancer Society, it says that 9,000 women would be diagnosed in the state of Illinois with cancer, and it has nothing to do with race and or age. It includes all women. And 2,000 men in the U.S. would be diagnosed with breast cancer, and out of that 2,000, 400 would die from it. So it's important that men get checked out as well. You are not exempt, and we know that cancer does not discriminate. So everyone needs to be cautious of their health. Be your own health advocate, be proactive and not reactive. So we're going to hear the rest of this incredible journey by Monica.
Okay. I'm not only a breast cancer survivor, I am a double cancer survivor. Not only did I have breast cancer, I had kidney cancer shortly after the breast cancer. Now imagine having surgery, which is the lumpectomy, and 6.5 weeks of chemo, 6.5 weeks of radiation, staying at home in bed, crawling to the bathroom, getting over that, and going back 6 months later, and the doctor tells you that there's a possibility that they see something else in the same breast.
Wow.
I didn't think I could take any more. After hearing those words, I decided to have a double mastectomy.
What brought you to that conclusion?
I didn't want to continue having the scare from 6 months to a year hearing the words of a possibility. Mm-hmm. So for precaution, I decided to do a double mastectomy. My surgeon decided to send me to a psychiatrist because he said I was too young to.
How old were you? I'm sorry.
49.
Okay.
I did go and see the psychiatrist, and with his professional help, I still decided not to. I decided to have the double mastectomy, but not do reconstruction. It was still hard for me because the new relationship I was in, the gentleman really mentally played a role where my self-esteem was really horrible. I think each time I came home from chemo, that was definitely a conversation that you're going to get this double mastectomy, and it's going to be the same size that you were before, which was 36 double D.
Oh, wow.
After the double mastectomy, after not having reconstruction, I healed pretty nicely and decided that I wanted to get a job. After trying to get out in the working world and be a normal human being, Mercy Hospital, driving for them, they decided to take a chance on me and gave me a position. In 2013, while I was working, I was rushed back to the emergency room and found out I had kidney cancer.
Wow.
Now, I'm thinking, obviously you didn't get the lesson that you didn't love yourself enough the first time. Now, this is, to me, worse than the first time. It's like, what are you going to do now? What are you going to do with your life? I got stronger. I started listening to a young lady who has her own show, The Love Journey, Janine Ingram. She played a major role in my life in trying to help me love me. I also want to say thank you to Virgie Gentry for taking me to my first breast cancer walk in 2009. And she's the reason why I'm here today, sitting here talking on the radio. I can give her support and other breast cancer survivors, but when it comes to the strength for myself, sometimes I feel like I don't have that. But I'm here.
Yes, you are, and that just proves just how strong you are because you are here. And I think a lot of times we don't give ourselves credit when we go through a journey such as this, because You was fighting for your life, not one time, but twice.
Yes.
And it takes someone who has strength. And you had to be given some supernatural strength just to get through this. Because anybody can go crazy. Anybody can go out of their mind given a diagnosis. And just the one time, just realizing everything that you have to go through. And then the second time, because you already know what you've been through.
Right.
And now here I am again. What's going to happen? Because this is a different type of cancer. So what's going to be the treatment? It's still kind of like unknown in a way.
Right.
And we was talking before, and I'm like, God, he make no mistakes. And although we want to be like, why? You know, you could think of a lot of other people who may deserve you know, but he make no mistakes, and he put us through it for a reason. Because he knew when we went through it that we wasn't going to just keep the testimony to ourselves, that we was going to share with other women to help make them strong, mm-hmm. and to help bring them through, and so that they can see through your life that he still heals.
Yes.
And I always talk about people always say, are you in remission? No. Remission means you're waiting on it to come back. I'm healed.
By his stripes.
Yes. And we all have, you have your moments to where, you know, if you have a little ache or pain here, you're like, oh, is that the cancer? Is it back? Like, what's, you know, we have those moments. Mm-hmm. But we just have to trust and believe that God does, he doesn't take back. If he gives it to you, he doesn't take it back from you. Mm-hmm. He reigns on the just as well as the unjust. So we may think, oh, I'm not deserving, you know. Why not you? Why not? He knows exactly where he wants you to be outside of this journey. He knows exactly what you're going to do. And he had to strip you of everything that was Monica, everything that's Rochelle, bring you closer to him so that you would be able to do exactly what he wants you to do, is what you're doing right now, sharing that journey with other people.
Yes.
And hoping that you can help change lives and save lives and get people to take action. That's what Warriors Talk is about. It's about taking action. Women, we know they're scared to get mammograms. Just for what you went through. You went through the situation to where you had to sit and wait. Mm-hmm. And that in itself can be devastating. So just to have someone there to either hold your hand while you're going through the mammogram to say, girl, I've been through this. Right. This is what's going to happen. Yeah, this is preliminary. They're going to have you sit here and do this. You're going to have to do the biopsy. You're going to have to do the ultrasound. I've been through this. Just to have somebody to sit there and go through those steps with you, I think it's very major. And I think we do have organizations out here that will do that, mm-hmm. you know, that will actually walk through the different steps with you. Mm-hmm. I believe when Virgie was on the show, she said she had to hold somebody's hand a couple of times. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you have to coach them into going to their appointments, because a lot of times they're like, I don't want to go. And you can't blame them, because you're afraid of what you're going to hear when you get there. Right. What are they going to do to me? And especially if you know what the chemo appointments are like. When I did my chemo appointment, and I know this was just God getting me ready, I went for the first appointment, and I was supposed to take the medicine at night. They gave me like 7 pills that you were supposed, I think I was supposed to take the Benadryl so I wouldn't have an allergic reaction to the chemo. Well, they forgot to tell me that I was supposed to take it. So when I get there, they're like, did you take your Benadryl? I'm like, no, nobody told me. And they was like, my doctor's like, well, you can't have chemo today. But he brought me and my mom there so we could actually see the setup. So we could see exactly what I was going to be doing, what the place looked like, mm-hmm. exactly how they hook you up and everything. And then, so we got to see that. So it kind of calmed our fears a little bit. So then when I went back the second week, I just happened to be on the internet looking at stuff. And then I read that, oh, make sure you go to the dentist before you go to make sure you need any teeth pulled, you need any dental work. You have to get that done before it happens, mm-hmm. before you take chemo. So I went to the dentist, and he was like, oh, you need some teeth pulled before you go. Like, you have an infection in one tooth. And I'm just like, what? He was like, I said, well, I'm about to get chemo. He was like, no, you're not. You're going to have to wait until you get the teeth pulled, and then you're going to have to come back after they heal. So it was about, my chemo was delayed 3 weeks. So I went back, and my doctor was like, are you doing this on purpose? I'm like, I'm not. And so she was like, go take care of your dental work and come back. And so I did that and came back. So a lot of things that other people who are in battle may not know, that we know, that we've been through, that we can share with them. Before you go into battle, this is what you need to do. So you certainly have people in your life that held your hand, that helped you with that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that was a blessing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So what would you say to someone, Monica, that's probably getting ready to go through this battle right now? What would you say to them to get them prepared?
Find strength within yourself. Dig way down deep. continue praying. If you hadn't started, find someone that can pray for you. Because that's what I did. I couldn't pray for me, so people were praying for me. And don't wait. I honestly wish I wouldn't have waited from August all the way until January, mm-hmm. being naive or just thinking I was untouchable, like I couldn't get cancer. Don't wait until the last minute. Keep a journal. Keep your medical history for each year that you, when the last time that you've had a mammogram. Mm-hmm. Don't wait. It is so important. And sometimes when you wait, it's too late. God just happened to be on my side. Mm. Where I waited, but I'm still here. And now that I've had it for the second time, I talk more now. The first time I got it, my mouth was closed. Mm. My mouth was closed.
Why was that? Were you ashamed of what you went through? Did you just didn't want anybody to get all up in your business? Like, what was behind that?
I think I was just probably too angry. Mm. I wanted to fight with the wind. So I didn't talk. I didn't talk about it, even to my family and no one else. And after that second time, and whenever someone asks me, I get nervous. And I can talk one-on-one with people that's going through it and even go to the doctor with them mm-hmm. without a problem. But now I talk. Honestly, it's hard to shut me up.
Once you get to talking.
Once I get to talking. So, having kidney cancer, being able to not have to take dialysis, they were able to save part of my kidney where I wouldn't have to take dialysis.
Now, that's a blessing in itself. You know that, right?
I know. And three other times after that, they thought it was in my right lung. They thought it was in my uterus. Mm. So there were several surgeries after the kidney cancer.
Trying to find out if something was there.
Yes. But by his stripes,
girl,
I am going to continue to talk to you and anyone else that would listen.
And I know I appreciate the journey because just hearing your story, I'm like, I ain't been through nothing. I'm like, oh my goodness. I mean, if you would just look at Monica, you would never know that she's been through anything. I mean, her skin is glowing. She just, like I said, her smile is so infectious. She's awesome. She's very humble. She's not, you know, a person that she's not bougie. She's a down-to-earth person. And we just connected for some reason when I first met her when she came on the show to support her friend, Virgie. And we just kind of connected. And I'm just like, I don't know what it is about her, but I just love her. Like, it's something about her. And now that I've heard, like, her story in depth, it just makes me love her anymore because I see the strength. I see the purpose. And I see the endless possibilities that God has on your life. And I'm glad that you are here to share your story. And I just wish that more women will open their mouths like you and tell their story so that they can help save the lives of other women. We know about breast cancer. We know it exists. But we don't do a lot about it. And I'm guilty. I'm guilty because my sister passed away in 2010. And I'm like, this don't run in our family. Now, had I been smart, I would have been like, let me get myself checked out. Because even if it doesn't, let's just figure out what's, you know. And I probably could have caught mine a little earlier. It was stage two, but I probably could have caught it a little earlier and maybe not had to go through everything I went through. So we have to get out of that mindset that it can't happen to me. Cancer don't care about you. Cancer does not care. Cancer doesn't discriminate. Cancer doesn't care if you have wedding plans. Cancer doesn't care if you get ready to go to college. Cancer doesn't care if you want to have grandbabies. Cancer doesn't care if you waiting on the love of your life. Cancer doesn't care. So we have to get busy living, taking care of ourselves, laugh, and just enjoying life in the moment. Stop stressing about all these little things that you can't even change. Give us some words of wisdom, Monica. I know you already dropped some on us already, but.
I think you summed it up pretty much.
Mm-mm, come on now. Now we got her talking. What would you want to say to people out there to let them know about cancer, about just life in general?
Yeah. As I said, make sure you... follow up with your doctor's appointments, you know, once a year, every 6 months, for not only just for mammograms, for your health, mm-hmm. physicals. And for me, start doing things to love myself and laugh a little. And not feel uncomfortable because I'm smiling. Mm.
That's why your smile's so bright.
So, that's it.
I totally agree with you. I think that cancer definitely has you in a place to where you appreciate life. And you just, certain things, you're just like, I'm just going to let that roll off because it's not even worth it. Mm-hmm. Even with relationships, you learn to like, that's not the relationship for me. Or if it's even stressful for you, try to take yourself out of that situation. Or I've learned to pick my battles with things. I've learned to just walk away or just not even open my mouth and say anything because it's not even worth my time. I do believe, and I've often said this, that my cancer came from stress. And
I agree.
And I was so stressed. And you know, always having been a healthy person and going to the doctor and always been healthy, always keep your appointments. You eat right. You don't eat perfect, but you eat the right foods. You're exercising. You're active.
Pretty much.
You know, and I had just had a baby. Just got done breastfeeding my baby in April. And then went to the doctor in July, she did the clinical exam. Nothing there. And then in November, it's a lump. And I asked my doctor, how? You just did the exam. She was like, the type of cancer, it was aggressive. So it's a possibility that it could have in those months. Yes. So that's why the clinical exams, so you have three different things that you can do. You can do your breast exams at home, yourself every month. And that's your defense mechanism. You can do have the clinical exams done once a year by your doctor. If the doctor doesn't offer it, ask. And then when the appropriate age comes, do your mammograms. Now, if somebody in your family had breast cancer, you know you go 10 years prior to them. So if it's 45, you go at 35. But if you're checking your breast every month and you notice a change, mark that change. If it stays the same, within 2 to 3 weeks, you should be seeing your doctor. So it's very important to get to know the norm of your body, get to know your body, the look, the feel, the touch. So when something is not normal, you're going to recognize it. And you're going to be able to go to your doctor and let them know exactly what's going on with you. And then you have to be honest with the doctors because a lot of times we're not honest. Like Monica didn't say, I had a lump.
No,
I have didn't. A lump. Because had you told them you had a lump, you would have been in there the next day. But that's okay. Mm-hmm. God covered you.
He did.
He covered you for a reason so that you could be here and to share your incredible journey with the people here. And I'm excited. Thank you so much, Monica, for sharing your story.
Oh, thank you for having me.
You're so welcome. And I just want to make sure that everybody know that we're going to be on UBM Talk instead of UBM Faith from now on. And hopefully we'll be going Facebook Live next week. We did some of it this week on Monica, so I will repost it on the page. So we will be on Mondays at 7 p.m. on UBM Talk, and I will post the information on my page. So warriors, remember that you cannot fight cancer alone, but with family, friends, and God on your side, you can walk out victorious. So warriors, remember to keep thriving and surviving.
Father God, we come before you tonight with praise and with thanksgiving. We want to thank you, O God, for every word that we have heard during this radio broadcast. We thank you, Lord, for using this vessel to share her wisdom and her knowledge and her experience. And God, we pray that every word that has been shared will be a word of hope and inspiration to those who have heard it. We thank you, O God, for Justice Ministry, and we ask, O God, that you will continue to let this ministry grow and to thrive. But most of all, we pray that this ministry will give you the glory. Father, you said in your word, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he has committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. And then you said, confess our faults to one another, and pray for one another that we may be healed. For the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Father, we realize that there is power in prayer, and there is power when we come together in your will. And so, God, we know who to go to, because many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God, you're able to deliver us out of them all. So, God, we come before you tonight asking you for your mercy, asking you for your grace, and, God, asking that your healing virtue will be released, oh, God, on these airways to touch those that are in need of healing, in need of deliverance, God, and in need of being made whole. God, have mercy tonight, Lord. Go into the hospital rooms. Go into the sick beds. Go into those places of confinement. Go into every place where my voice is being heard. And God, I pray that you will lay your hands on every man, every woman, every son, and every daughter. Lay your hands, O God, on them from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet. And God, I pray that you will drive every trace of sickness out of their bodies right now, in the matchless name of Jesus. And God, will give your name the praise, and the glory shall be thine. In Jesus' name, we believe it done. Thank God. Thank God. Amen and amen.
You have just tuned in to Warriors Talk with your host, Lady Rochelle. Warriors, remember, early detection, knowing your risk, reducing your risk, knowing your family history, and selecting healthier lifestyle choices are keys to saving lives. And always remember to thrive while surviving.